Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Mande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The heinous hermit Ravana came with the intention to abduct Sita. That is what we saw in the last part. Now, this part of the series of Ramayana, the part 28, is termed as Eagle Emancipated. As Ravana carried Sita in his Pushpaka Vimana, Sita very piteously wailed out and requested all the flowers, creepers, trees, animals, river Godavari, everyone around, to convey to Rama that she was being abducted by Ravana. So piteously she wailed that even these aspects, these creatures, these beings would probably have had tears in their eyes. Even the animals would have had tears. Even the trees would have withered off their leaves as a mark of sorrow of Sita. And Ravana swiftly passed through the sky on his chariot, the Pushpaka Vimana. He was perceived by the eagle Jatayu. Now, many people think and speak of Jatayu as a vulture, but Jatayu was an eagle because Jatayu was the son of the brother of the eagle king Garuda. Jatayu was the son of Aruna, the brother of Garuda. And so, there's no doubt that he was an eagle and he was ruling over that part of the eagle community in the Dandakaranya forest. So, this eagle king Jatayu, who was also a friend of Dasharatha and who was very fond of Sita and Rama, saw the sight of the abduction of Sita. He was startled. He tried to go to Ravana and reason out to him that what he was doing was very unbecoming of him. He said, it is very wrong to even think of possessing the spouse of another man. And you are a king, O Ravana. You may be the king of augurs, but you are a king. And a king ought to provide protection to women folk in general. Not only that, you belong to the race of sage Pulastya. Please do not bring disgrace to that race by this baseful act of yours. Ravana would not pay heed to one word of Jatayu. He just proceeded without even giving the least attention to Jatayu's words. Then Jatayu decided to meet him in combat. He flew and hit the Pushpaka Vimana with his wings. This enraged Ravana and he started hitting Jatayu with weapons. Then for a while, he landed the Pushpaka Vimana and both of them happened to fight. It is said that it seemed like two large mountains were clashing against each other. Two clouds impelled by a blast were creating noise in the sky. Such was the great fight between Jatayu and Ravana. But Ravana, who was possessed of extraordinary prowess, finally pierced the eagle Jatayu with his sharp pointed arrows and brutally wounded him. Jatayu fell down. As he fell down, Sita Devi couldn't control herself. She went and held on to Jatayu and wailed out loudly. She said, I have lost another father of mine. One father whom I lost was my father-in-law, Dasharatha. And now, this father-like figure Jatayu has also laid his life down only for my sake. What will I tell Rama? How will I answer him if he asks me where is Jatayu when we meet? I have to say he laid down his life for my sake. Oh my God, why did this disdainful day dawn at all? Saying such things, she wailed out loudly. The horrendous Ravana couldn't bear to see this sight and he again pulled Sita by the hair, kept her in the Pushpaka Vimana and started riding back to Lanka. This was really a pathetic scene. Jatayu was almost reaching his end, but he held on his life to tell Rama the information about the abduction of Sita by Ravana. Very difficult the situation was for Jatayu and for Sita. As Sita was travelling across the sky in the Pushpaka Vimana, she found that 5 monkeys were playing around in a tree. Some intuition in her prompted her to pack all her jewels in a piece of cloth which was torn from her sari, make it into a bundle and throw it down. She threw down that bundle of her jewels to the monkeys, which the monkeys caught. They were surprised, but they saw that this lady was being carried by an auger in the sky and she threw away these jewels. And these monkeys were residents of the kingdom of Kishkinda. How these monkeys helped Rama later, we shall get to know. After this, the Pushpaka Vimana proceeded and landed directly only in Lanka. As Ravana entered his beautiful golden city of Lanka, he was very proud of himself that he had got the most beautiful woman in the world to his city. And he tried to persuade her by n number of means to become his wife. He said he would make her the principal queen and all his other consorts would be servants of hers. He said he would give away all the wealth that he had and put it at her feet. And he would himself be of service to Sita if she accepted to become his wife. All these were like molten lead poured into the ears of Sita. She was feeling so miserable. And she said, I know that my Lord will come back to take me. And how can you even think of dishonoring my womanhood by asking me such questions? It is understood that your fateful day of destruction is going to come very soon at the hands of my master, Rama. Now, Ravana had a curse that he could not touch any woman without her consent. Because of that, he could not forcefully molest Sita. And so he decided to give her a year's time. He said, I will give you time of 1 year. You live in this Ashoka grove of mine. And he took her to that Ashoka grove and kept her there in the guard of many ugly looking ogresses. And these ogresses, Rakshasis, were to not only keep guard on Sita, but also try to convince her to become Ravana's wife. So Ravana told her, for a year, you try and change your mind. If by the end of the year, you don't change your mind, I will have you for breakfast. He just said that and he went away. And Sita sat there in the Ashoka grove all alone with these scary Rakshasis surrounding her, whose talks were even more scary. And in this piteous condition, she lived bearing that agony, knowing that her master would come to save her and that all this was a part of fate which had something better in store in future. That night, Indradeva, the ruler of the gods, Devas, came down with a divine payasa and he told Sita Devi that for her sustenance through these months of torture at the Ashoka Vana, she must partake the payasa. By taking that, she would be bereft of hunger and thirst. Indra told Sita, I know you will not eat a morsel of food or drink a drop of water from this place. So to keep you alive all these days till Rama comes back, take this payasa. Sita Devi accepts it and she's there in the Ashoka Grove waiting for Rama. Back there at Panchavati, after killing Maricha, Rama felt all signs of ill omens occurring around him. So he hurried back towards his Paranashala at Panchavati. On his way back, he found Lakshmana coming in the opposite direction. Rama was taken aback. He said, Lakshmana, why are you here? Why are you not with Sita now? Why did you leave her alone? And so many questions he had to ask him. Then Lakshmana patiently explained to him that they heard the cry of Rama calling out Sita and Lakshmana, and Sita Devi was so concerned that she forced Lakshmana to go to Rama. So saying, Lakshmana said, I had no other choice but to come to you, O brother, leaving sister-in-law alone. Rama felt the pinch of the situation even more now. He said, now I understand something has grossly gone wrong. Come, let's hurry back to the ashrama. And when they reached their place, they found everything lying around scattered. Flowers, twigs, things in the house, all were in a scattered manner. And when Rama looked into the house and searched for Sita, she was to be found nowhere. He called out loudly, Hey Sita, Hey Sita. There was no reply. Then he went around searching in the nearby woods where sometimes Sita would go just to enjoy nature. She was not to be found there too. Then Rama understood that the situation was really alarming. Sita was missing. Where was she? Who would tell him now? All these flowers, all these trees, all these creepers, they couldn't speak. They could only express their sorrow by withering away or by making noises. Who would tell Rama where was Sita? Rama started walking along the forest, and after covering some distance, he found Jatayu lying brutally wounded. He was shocked. He took Jatayu on his lap and asked him, what happened? Why am I seeing this in front of my eyes? What a sight is this? What happened to you, my dear Jatayu? And Jatayu then told him in the minimal possible words that Sita and his life both have been taken away by Ravana. He did not stop with this. He said, do not worry about this, but because the time, the hour at which Ravana took away Sita is called as Vindan, and that is a time which is very auspicious in the sense that if somebody loses something at that time, he's sure to find it back. Yenayati muhurtena Sita madaya Ravana vipranashtam dhanam kshipram tatswami pratipadyate vindo nama muhurto sau nachaka kutsthasvo budhat. So, since he abducted Sita at this time, you are sure to find her back. I am sure of that. That's what the Jyotish Shastra says. So take heart, my son, and be sure that you will find back Sita very soon. But I am really sorry that I couldn't do anything to stop Ravana from taking her away. I tried my best, but all like that I could give up is my life. But the purpose still stands unachieved. So saying, the eagle breathed his last in the lap of Sri Rama. Sri Rama wailed out piteously, saying that I lost my father, Dasharatha, and today I lost his friend, who is another father to me. But he said, I was not able to perform the last rites of my father when he passed away. Today I shall do that for this father of mine. So saying, he performed the last rites of Jatayu, a privilege that even Dasharatha himself did not get. Not only that, before Jatayu passed away, Rama told him something very important. He said, I shall permit you to go to the higher world. You go and go to the ultimate world of Sri Vaikuntha. Mayatvam samanujnyatah gachalokan anuttaman gridhraja mahasatva samskritascha maya vraja. You shall reach the ultimate world being permitted by me, said Rama. Now Rama was playing the role of a man. So how could he now show up his tendency of being Lord Vishnu and actually telling Jatayu to reach the netherworld, the world of supreme happiness? How was it possible? Is it that the Lord forgot that he was playing the role of a man? The answer that is given by experts in the field is that it is not true that the Lord forgot the role that he was playing. He was well aware. But there is also another factor, that if somebody is always speaking the truth, somebody who never forsakes the truth for anything, will utter words which become true. So Rama was known as Satyavachi, the one who always speaks the truth. So here it implies that Rama was acting somebody like a sage. Sages generally pronounce boons or curses, saying that if I have been speaking the truth always, if I have been performing austerities rightly, then may this come true. So also Rama here said without saying that if I have been speaking the truth always, let this eagle attain emancipation. And it did, because Rama was a speaker of the truth only. Thus, Rama did not violate his own principle of playing human in this avatara. In the Rama avatara, Rama always tried to behave like a human being, not showing his supernatural powers. Here, though it may appear that he showed his supernatural powers, the interpretation given is that he did not show his supernatural power. Instead, he just established that he was a perfect speaker of the truth. So whatever he spoke became true. So he said, this eagle for his sacrifice will attain emancipation, and it did. So this was the story of the eagle Jatayu attaining emancipation by the grace of Lord Rama. What happened later, we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namatarakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 29. A friend in need. Sugreeva Sakhyam. That's the topic of today. We saw that after the abduction of Sita by Ravana, Rama kept searching for her all over the forest, where he met the eagle king Jatayu, who was in a position to almost give up his life. He was brutally wounded and waiting to give the news about Sita's abduction to Rama. He very comfortingly told Rama that Sita had been abducted by Ravana and they flew in the southern direction. So saying, Jatayu laid down his life on the laps of Sri Rama and he was granted emancipation by Rama. After this, Rama really felt very, very depressed for having lost his father-like figure Jatayu too, and really not knowing how to proceed to search for Sita, he kept wandering all over the forest in the southern direction, when suddenly a very fearful figure came in front of them and caught hold of Rama and Lakshmana. Who was this? This was Kabanda, a demon who did not have any particular form. He had a very ugly looking form with his mouth in the belly and hands which were as long as 8 miles. And with those two hands, he caught hold of Rama and Lakshmana. Rama and Lakshmana tried to free themselves from this clutch, but they were unable to. So, using their sharp arrows, they cut down these hands of this Kabanda. The moment the hands of Kabanda were cut, he turned into a very beautiful form and he prostrated before Rama. He said, "I am actually Kabanda, the son of an asura named Danu. It so happened that I was tormenting everybody who were living in the forest, and a rishi named Stulashiras cursed me because of that. He said, 'You are doing such ugly deeds that you will get an ugly form. And how will you get that ugly form? You will get that ugly form by receiving a blow from the Vajrayudha of Indra.' And it so happened that Indra struck me with his Vajrayudha and my heads and thighs all entered into my abdomen. Now I had my mouth in the belly. I asked Indra, 'How will I eat?' For that sake, he made my hands 8 miles long. And he said, 'You catch hold of any prey that you get with these hands and eat it.' I felt miserable and I also felt remorseful. So at that time, the sage granted me redemption, saying that one day you will catch hold of Rama, who will sever your hands, and that will be redemption for you. You will get back your original form once this happens. Once Rama comes into your clutches, you will be redeemed from the clutches of my curse.' And that's exactly what has happened." So saying, he prostrated and he got into his ethereal form and was about to ascend to heaven. At that time, he gave a piece of very useful information to Rama. He said, "O Rama, I know you're looking out for your wife Sita, and I know who can help you with this. Who can help you find Sita? There is this monkey chief called Sugreeva, who will help you in restoring Sita back to yourself. Go and seek his help. He lives on the banks of the river Pampa, which is not very far from here," said Kabanda. Rama thanked him for this information and proceeded towards where Sugreeva was supposed to be residing. Kabanda had told him that there is this Rishyamukha hill near the lake Pampa, and that was the place where the monkey Sugreeva resided. So Rama went in that direction, trying to find out where this place exactly was. On his way, he found the hermitage of Shabari. Shabari was an ardent devotee of Lord Vishnu, and she had been performing bhakti yoga. She had been resorting to the path of devotion to get liberated, the path of unhalted, deep-rooted devotion called bhakti yoga, in order to get emancipated. And it is said that she had been practicing this from her previous janma. And now it was the time for her to actually get emancipated. Shabari was waiting for emancipation, but before she got emancipation, she had this desire to meet Rama with this naked eye, this bodily eye that she had. She wanted to see Rama with these eyes of hers before she ascended to the other world, the Nitya Vibhuti, Sri Vaikuntha. So she was waiting for Rama. As Rama came, she recognized him and she was so overwhelmed with joy that she clasped his feet tightly and was not ready to leave it also. This aged Shabari caught the feet of the 30-year-old Rama the 30-year-old Rama, who was the lord of the universe, Shabari knew, not the others. So it seemed a very interesting sight to the lookers-by. But the lookers-by were also sages who more or less knew that Rama was none other than Lord Vishnu incarnate. Stationed before Rama, when Shabari was finding it hard to find words to speak, Rama himself asked her, "Have all your impediments been thoroughly overcome by you? Is your asceticism steadily growing? Are all your religious vows completed? Are you in a position to attain the liberation that you have been seeking? Do you think everything that you had to perform is over?" To this, Shabari replied, saying, "Today I have found the fruit of my austerities being attained by your blessed sight, O Rama. Today my birth as a human being has borne fruit, and the penance of my elders have become true. They have given the desired result. My asceticism, my penance practice has become fruitful only today. And even the highest of heavens will be low as compared to this experience of seeing you with these naked eyes. Hallowed by your gracious look, bestowing honor on me, I am sure to ascend to the realms of that world where no decay exists." So saying, Shabari shed tears of joy and offered fruits and roots to Rama and Lakshmana, which they both partook happily. And then taking leave of Shabari and seeing her ascend the other world, these princes moved forward. It is said that Lord Rama stood as a witness to the attainment of moksha by Shabari. Avandhya mahima muni jana bhajana mushita hridaya kalusha Shabari moksha sakshi bhuta, says Swami Deshikan. From there, they proceeded towards the Pampa Lake, and they saw that this was the Rishyamukha hill where Sugriva was supposed to be residing. But where do they go looking for one monkey in a big hilly area? So they were wondering what to do, when Sugriva, who was present in the ashrama of sage Matanga at Rishyamukha hill, saw these two princes coming by. Sugriva saw Rama and Lakshmana from far, and he was suspicious that they may be from the enemy camp. Now, who was Sugriva's enemy and why was he scared of him? All those stories will follow suit. But currently, let us understand that Sugriva suspected that Rama and Lakshmana were probably enemies who had come to cause him some harm. So he wanted to find out who they really were. So he sent his trusted minister Hanuman to go and find out as to who these two princely looking men were. The men looked princely by their appearance, but they were wearing garments of hermits. So this confused Sugriva even more. And very anxiously he told Hanuman to immediately go and find out as to who they were. Accordingly, Hanuman came to the banks of the river Pampa, where these two princes were, and asked them in the most polite and beautiful words as to who they were. And he also very genuinely and candidly revealed his identity to them, saying that he was a minister of Sugriva who was banished from his kingdom by his elder brother Vaali, and that he sought friendship in these two people who looked like sages but had a gait and style of princes. Very beautifully he worded his phrases such that these people would be convinced that what Hanuman spoke was genuine, and even if they had come with an intent to harm Sugriva, they would go back after listening to this humble submission of Hanuman. Rama was absolutely astonished hearing the speech of Hanuman. He very happily exclaimed to Lakshmana, saying that, "Lakshmana, I have not seen another person who has spoken like him till today. To speak in the way that he has done is not possible without a detailed study of the Rig Veda, the Samaveda and the Yajur Veda. Naan Rig Veda Vinitasya, na Yajur Veda Dharinaha, na Samaveda Vidishu. Na Samaveda Vidushaha, Shakyamevam Vibhashitum, Nyunam Vyakaranam Kritsnam Anena Bahudashrutam, Bahuvyaharata Nena Nakinchit Apashabditam." He spoke a good deal, but he spoke not a single wrong word in that. Though he spoke so many sentences, there was not a single apashabda or wrong word said in that speech. The speech emanating from his bosom is articulated by his throat and marked by its purity. It is unambiguous, unfaltering, and it makes a grating impression on one's ears. Look at the way he has spoken. The way he has spoken is most impressive, and the information he gave is even more soothing. What did he say? He said he was the minister of Sugreeva, that Sugreeva whom these people were trying to find, that Sugreeva who was a promising help for them as said by Kabanda, that Sugreeva who was their friend in need now. And Hanuman had said that that same Sugreeva was seeking their friendship. So Sugreeva too was in need of this friend Rama. So thus Rama now had found his friend in need, Sugreeva. Then he went ahead to meet Sugreeva, taking Hanuman's assistance. And the two of them met. And a great bond of friendship ensued between them. They first discussed their plights. Rama told him how Sita had been abducted by Ravana and how he came looking for her and was guided by Kabanda to come and seek help from him. Sugreeva on his part poured out his grievance and said that he too sought help from Rama in order to get back his kingdom and his wife from his elder brother Vaali. What that story was, we shall see in the next part. But after listening to the story of Sugreeva, Rama assured him that he would be of help to him, and Sugreeva too assured back that he too would help Rama find Sita. And to mark their bond of friendship, the two of them circumambulated a holy fire and vowed each other friendship for life. Thus, both Rama and Sugreeva had found a friend in need for each other, who were none other than each other themselves. Pujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Mande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra tatra grita mastakanjalim Bashpavari paripurna lochanam Marutim namataraksha santakam Vaidehi sahitam suradrumatale Haime mahamantape Madhye pushpakamasane manimaye Veerasane sustitam Agreva chayati prabhanjanasute Tatvam munibhyav param Vyakhyantam bharatadibihi parivritam Ramam bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 30. A friend indeed. That's the topic of today. Rama was told by Kabanda that if he would meet Sugreeva, the monkey king, and take his help, it would be easy for him to find Sita. Accordingly, Rama went in search of Sugreeva to the Rishyamukha hill, and he was spotted by Sugreeva as he reached the banks of the river Pampa, which is situated near the Rishyamukha hill. And Sugreeva sent Hanuman as a messenger to find out who these two princes were, Rama and Lakshmana, the two men who seemed like princes. Who were they? And Hanuman very beautifully found out who they were, and the two of them met, Rama and Sugreeva, and they realized that both of them were in almost the same plight of having lost their wife and being away from their kingdom. There ensued a very thick friendship between the two, and this friend Sugreeva told his friend Rama his tale of woe. He told Rama, "Rama, I have an elder brother named Vaali, and we were the best of brothers. There was not a single day when Vaali would not pour his affection on me. We always ate together, drank together, slept together, and Vaali was no less than a father to me, and I also felt very, very attached to him. Till one day, a demon named Mayavi came to our kingdom, Kishkinda, and Vaali went to have a fight with him. And Mayavi couldn't withstand the blows of Vaali and started running away. Ultimately, they both reached a cave, and before entering the cave, Vaali told me that you stand outside this cave, safeguarding the entrance so that nobody enters or nobody leaves. Till I come out, you must be here. Thus, taking an oath from me, Vaali went inside. And the combat ensued for a year, Rama. The fight went on for a whole long year, and I stood there, true to my vow, not moving from that place that long. But at the end of that time, terrible noises were heard from inside the cave, and I saw streams of blood flowing out of the cave. I feared that Vaali had been slain by that terrible demon Mayavi. And I thought now he might come out and harm our kingdom too. I did not want that. So out of fear and out of panic at that moment, I closed the mouth of that cave with a big stone, and I offered water to the deceased, to my brother Vaali. I thought he was dead. And I returned back to the kingdom very, very sad. And I told everyone what happened. The ministers of Kishkinda immediately said that our kingdom should not be without a king, and so we shall coronate you as the next king. And they did that. I told them, I protested, I said, no, let the crown be passed on to Angada. But they all said, no, Angada is but a child. Angada was the son of Vaali. He is but a child. So you should take charge. You should do the duties that your elder brother was performing. Take over the kingdom of Kishkinda. And they had just finished performing the ablution for coronation, and water was dripping from my crown. At that time, Vaali suddenly appeared into Kishkinda, into our palace. And trust me, Rama, my happiness knew no bounds on seeing him. I went rushing forward with a wet crown on my head and sought his blessings. I fell at his feet. I said, oh, my dear brother, you're back. I can't thank heavens enough for this. And Vaali at that moment kicked the crown off my head and kicked me away. He said, you traitor, you took away my kingdom and crown and throne just by locking me up in that cave and declaring me dead. How could you do this to me? You don't deserve to be called my brother anymore. Get lost. And he kicked me out of the kingdom immediately. And to add on to that misery, he said, now your wife will be mine. And he took charge of her too and just drove me away from the kingdom. and now I am in this miserable state with a few monkeys who followed me out of compassion for me, out of their love for me. And one was this trusted minister Hanuman. And thus I am here in this mountain, driven away by Vaali. Vaali chased me till I actually left the borders of our land. In fact, he chased me till I came here to the Rishimukha hill. But here he couldn't enter because of a curse, said Sugreeva. Rama asked what that curse was about. Sugreeva answered that after a while, it so happened that the brother of Mayavi named Dundubi came to fight with Vaali, and Vaali conquered him in no time and actually hurled the body of Dundubi and threw it away. He threw it so far that it came and fell at the ashrama of sage Matanga, who lives on this Rishyamukha hill. That body, which is spitting out blood, came and fell in the hermitage of this pious sage. The sage felt so disgusted looking at this that he immediately pronounced a curse, saying that if the person who is responsible for this sinful act ever enters the precincts of my ashram, his head will burst into 1,000 pieces. So he has this curse that he cannot enter the vicinity of the ashrama of sage Matanga. So he cannot visit this hill, the Rishimukha hill, on which the ashrama is placed. And so I came to this ashrama as my refuge, and I live only here. If I try to go anywhere outside, Vaali will come chasing me and he is after my life, and I do not know what to do. You must help me defeat Vaali. You must help me kill Vaali, because there is no point in defeating him. He will not be silent unless he is completely silenced forever. And he has done a grave wrong. He has taken my wife from me, which is unpardonable, Rama. Rama said, I understand your grievance, my dear friend. I will ensure that you are at peace very soon. I will defeat your enemy, Vaali, because your enemy is my enemy now. So, he advised Sugreeva to call Vaali for a combat, and when they would be fighting, Rama would kill Vaali from hiding with an arrow. So, this was the plan devised, and accordingly, Sugreeva went and invited Vaali for a combat. Vaali came out with full anger and he just wanted to smash Sugreeva to death. Sugreeva fought his might, and in no time he was overpowered by Vaali. And it was time for Rama to send his arrow, but Rama did not. Rama was not sending the arrow, and then Sugreeva had no other option but to run back to the Rishyamukha hill. When he returned back, he felt very, very humiliated. And he told Rama, Rama, if you were not going to kill Vaali, you should have told me. At least I would have escaped getting beaten up from him again. What is this? Why did you do this? To this, Rama replied, please do not scold me, my friend. Do not think I cheated on you. You two brothers look so similar to each other that it was difficult for me to differentiate between you both. Had I sent my arrow to pierce you instead of Vaali, that would have been such a disaster. So to avoid that, I kept quiet. Now this time, you make a mark for yourself. You have some identification mark so that I can see you. And for that purpose, Rama made Lakshmana put a garland onto Sugriva's neck so that he could be identified as Sugreeva. Now it is said that Sugreeva did not hold Lakshmana in high esteem till then. He thought Lakshmana is just like a servant of Rama. But Rama wanted Sugreeva to realize that Lakshmana is so important to him that he made Sugreeva receive a garland from Lakshmana. He had to bow down his neck to Lakshmana to receive that garland. So Rama wanted to prove to Sugreeva that Lakshmana was so dear to him. And one more thing, Lakshmana was Lakshmi Sampanna. He had all kinds of prosperity with him because he had the biggest prosperity of doing divine service. So, if the prosperous one garlanded Sugreeva, victory was sure for him. So, he made Lakshmana garland Sugreeva and Sugreeva once again called out Vaali for fight. This time, the Lord made no mistake because he could so easily identify Sugreeva because of the garland that he sent one sharp arrow which pierced the chest of Vaali and there he fell down to the ground, fatally wounded. Once Vaali fell, Rama came out from hiding. He had sent the arrow from hiding. Vaali was very upset when he saw Rama. He said, Rama, if you wanted to fight with me, you should have come in front of me and fought. What is this? Why did you hit me from the back, from hiding? That's not becoming of you and such a death is not fit for me. Why did you do this? Asked Vaali. Rama replied, Vaali, you have done a grave wrong to your brother by taking away his wife. So you deserve this punishment. And also, this entire land of Bharata is under the control of my brother now. He is reigning the land with under the headship of my Padukas. So, it is my duty to protect anybody who comes into my refuge. And your brother came to my refuge and his cause was right. So, I had to grant him asylum. And thirdly, you are an animal. You are a monkey. And I am a Kshatriya. So, a Kshatriya hunting an animal is dharma by itself. It is normal for Kshatriyas to go for hunting. It's a norm for them. And I can consider this as hunting an animal too. An animal is never warned before it is hunted. So, it was not wrong that I sent my arrow from hiding too. And this punishment you have got because you have done a grave wrong of abducting another man's wedded wife. Once Vaali heard these words, wisdom dawned upon him and he sought the forgiveness of Rama and told him to remove the arrow. Once the arrow was removed, Vaali thanked Rama and advised Sugreeva to take care of the kingdom. And he also requested Rama to take care of Angada. And finally he breathed his last. Now Rama had shown his friend Sugreeva that he was a friend indeed. He showed in action indeed that he was his friend and he had kept up his promise of friendship here. He had promised Sugreeva that his problem would soon be gone. His misery would soon be resolved. And that's exactly what he did. It seems Sugreeva did not have great trust on Rama when Rama made this promise. That's why he put Rama to a couple of tests before he actually told him to go ahead with the playing of Vaali. What Sugreeva did to test Rama was, he said, the skeleton of that demon Dundubi, whom Vaali had kicked to the ashrama of sage Matanga, was lying around there. So, Sugreeva asked Rama, in order to test your prowess, I would like you to kick this skeleton. It seems Rama kicked that skeleton and it went several kilometers away. However, Sugreeva was not too convinced even with this feat of Rama. He said, my brother hurled this Dundubi when he was alive, when he was with blood and flesh. Now that is so much more heavier than a dried skeleton. So he was not too convinced. So he put another test to Rama. He told Rama that my brother Vaali can shake and uproot trees in just one go. And he showed 7 sal trees, which were not in a single alignment, but placed away from each other. And he said, these trees are really sturdy ones and Vaali can shake them off fruits, shake them and make the fruits fall in no time. So can you pierce any one of these trees with your arrows? Asked Sugreeva. And this he would take as a mark of excellence. This is a test that Rama had to pass for Sugriva to believe him. Now Rama passed this test with outstanding performance. He took out one arrow and he sent it across such that it pierced all the 7 sal trees by aligning them into a row, and then it went down to Patala Loka and returned back to Rama's quiver. And all this happened in one muhurta, it is said, less than an hour. All this happened so soon, and Sugriva just kept looking on in awe. Now he believed Rama. So Rama had to show in deed to maintain the friendship of Sugriva. He had to prove himself to Sugriva so that he believed him. And after Sugriva believed him, he called Vaali for combat. And after the first defeat, now finally again Rama proved indeed that he was always there to solve any problem for one who has sought refuge in him. Thus, the friendship of Sugriva, which came up at the time of his need, proved to be a friendship indeed with the Vada of Vaali, or with the slaying of Vaali. Thus, Rama proved that he was a friend indeed. And now it was the turn of Sugriva to prove that he too was a friend indeed. How did he prove that? We shall see in the next part.